By now Christianity was the major religion in all of Sweden, but it's important to understand just how and why Scandinavia was Christianized. People didn't simply convert because it was the cool thing to do, although it totally was the cool thing to do. As Sweden entered the Middle Ages and joined the rest of Europe, it was crucial for the political leaders to find allies outside of Scandinavia, otherwise they stood no chance in the long run. Therefore, the Christianization began at the very top of society, with kings, earls, and lords adopting the new religion in order to make powerful allies across the Baltic Sea. And since Gotland is geographically closer to Europe, they converted first, while the Swedes to the north remained faithful to their Aesir and Vanir gods. Of course, it was difficult as a king to rule a people of a different religion, so it was in their best interest to convert their people as well, starting with their lords and earls, and letting them continue with their people. That's how Scandinavia became Christian. It also helped that Odinism was far more accepting of general changes in society. There were no written rules to follow, which made it easier for Scandinavians to convert on a moral level. And while the Viking religion focuses mainly on male warriors, where Valhalla is the ultimate afterlife, Christianity focuses on the individual. No matter birth, ethnicity, gender, or wealth, anyone could reach heaven. We can thereby see how this new religion might have been an attractive one for women and workers. The year was 1130. With the royal house of Sweden extinct, the Ostrogothic lord Sverker was elected the new king. Sverker the First, or Sverker the Elder as he would be remembered, legitimized his rule by marrying the widow of the previous king, Inge the Younger, and ruled Sweden from the seat of his house, Kaga, in Ostrogothia. Unlike their Westrogothic kin, the Ostrogoths had very good relations with the Swedes, and so Sverker's rule was peaceful. Meanwhile, the Swedes spread their influence across the Baltic and eventually, through trade and war, as well as an increased migration and superior technology, established a permanent foothold in the eastern lands, in what we today call Finland proper. Thus, Swedish dominion over Finland, which would last for approximately 660 years, had started. In 1156, Sverker the Elder was murdered by his servant, who himself wished to be king. With the old king dead, the Swedes and the Westrogoths crowned Erik the Ninth, who made himself famous to history by leading the mythical First Swedish Crusade into the Eastern Lands. Not much is known of this crusade, and many doubt it even happened. Regardless, because of this, Erik the Ninth would be remembered as Saint Erik the Holy, or just Erik the Saint. And after his death, he would become the patron saint of Sweden, as well as the coat of arms for the future capital. King Erik was murdered in 1160 by the Danish prince Magnus Henriksson, who usurped the kingdom and crowned himself King Magnus II of Sweden. He claimed legitimacy through his great-great-grandfather, Inge the Younger, of House Stenkil. The Ostrogoths refused to accept both Erik and Magnus, and so they chose Karl, the son of King Sverker the Elder, to be their king. The Danish usurper king was very unpopular in Sweden, and so, after less than a year as king, he was killed by Karl's forces in the Battle of Örebro. After the death of Magnus, Karl was crowned King Karl the Seventh of Sweden. Of course, many Westrogoths thought that Erik the Saint had been the rightful king, and that his son, Knut, was the true heir. And so began the conflict between the House of Erik and the House of Sverker, which would last for 120 years. King Karl was generally accepted as king throughout Sweden, but the power of the Eriks was not to be underestimated. Knut, the son of Erik the Saint, waged war against the Ostrogothic Sverkers, and in 1167, Karl was murdered by Knut on the island Visingsö. His family was forced to flee to Denmark. Thus, the House of Erik took control of Sweden, with Knut the First as their king. Of course, this was contested by the Ostrogothic supporters of the Sverkers, who crowned Karl and Burislev, the nephews of Karl the Seventh, co-regents of Sweden. In truth, however, they only ruled Ostrogothia. Burislav died in 1169 and Kol 4 years later, both fighting Canute. The Sverkers were temporarily defeated. Knut I is considered to be the most powerful king of Sweden this far, as he had a significant influence in both Gothland and Svealand. But Sweden was still unstable and vulnerable. In 1187, pagans from the east, possibly Karelians, Estonians or Curonians, sailed into Lake Malar and pillaged Sigtuna. Some believe they were sent by Sweden's main rival to the east, the Novgorodian Rus, whom had warred with the Swedes ever since 1142. The town recovered quickly, however, and the crown wasn't too badly affected since Knut ruled chiefly from Westrogothia. After almost 30 years on the throne, Knut I died of natural causes. As all four of his sons were too young to rule the kingdom, the Sverker seized the opportunity and returned from Denmark, after which they crowned Sverker II, King of Sweden, also known as Sverker the Younger. The sons of Knut were taken in to live at the royal court. As they grew older, however, they too claimed the crown, and were therefore not killed, but exiled to Norway, a decision Sverker surely regretted later. His position as King of Sweden was shaky at best, as four other kings were now united against him and claimed his kingdom together. In 1205, the sons of Knut returned to Sweden with an army, supported by the Birkebeiner party of Norway. Sverker II defeated them at the Battle of Elgarås. Jon, Knut and Joar died fighting, but the fourth and youngest one, Erik, managed to flee back to Norway. History would know him as Erik the Survivor, as he returned once more in 1208 and defeated Sverker at the Battle of Lena. Sverker the Younger fled to Denmark and Erik the Survivor was crowned Erik the X of Sweden. Sverker returned 2 years later with a Danish army to take back his kingdom, but was defeated and killed in the Battle of Gestilren. Meanwhile, the Swedes subjugated the Tavastians in the east. The Battle of Lena was the first Swedish battle in which cavalry played a major role. We can thereby see that the European way of fighting had spread to Sweden by now. Erik the X died in 1216 of a sudden fever, after which Johan of the House of Sverker was elected king at the age of 15, earning him the nickname Johan the Child. King Johan's reign was important, as it was he who gave the church a more financially privileged position in Swedish society. Johan also took part in the Livonian Crusade, invading western Estonia. The Swedes built a fort at Lijula, but was defeated later the same year by the natives of Saaremaa in the Battle of Lijula. Johan died in 1222, unmarried and without heirs. Thus the House of Sverker went extinct, and the son of Erik the X, Erik the XI, was crowned king instead. In truth, Erik was king in name only, as he was only 6 years old when he became king. His rule was therefore very unstable, and the political party known as the True Folkungs, who fought for the ancient right of free men to elect their own kings, rebelled and installed Knut II, another member of the House of Erik, as king in 1229, forcing Erik to flee to Denmark, which by 1231 ruled the entire province of Blekingia. Meanwhile, the Tavastians rebelled and declared independence. Knut the Tall, as he was known, ruled from Uppland for 5 years until the 18-year-old Erik retook his kingdom and killed Knut. The Folkungs was severely weakened but continued the fight in Uppland, electing Knut's son, Holmgr, as their new king. Holmgr was defeated at the Battle of Sparsätra 13 years later and was later executed. Erik the XI, or Erik the Lisp and Lame as he would later be known, spent the rest of his reign securing the eastern lands as part of Sweden. In 1249 he launched the second Swedish crusade together with his brother-in-law Birger Jarl, defeating the rebellious Tavastians in eastern Finland and establishing a border with the Novgorodians. King Erik suddenly died the next year, however, and with him the House of Erik died out as well. Once again, Sweden found itself without a royal house, but this time was different. Birger Jarl had taken on much of the responsibility of the king, and is today traditionally attributed to have founded Stockholm, the capital of Sweden. But more on that in the next episode. Although he never claimed the title king, he ruled as the last Jarl of Sweden, while his son, Valdemar, was crowned the new king. Thus, the House of Bjälbo became the new royal house of Sweden, and the wars between the Sverkers and the Eriks was finally over.